The air, and I was just explaining to the listeners, you were on with me last month. We talked a little bit about the book that you have coming out next month, and we are going to reconvene next month on I think the eve of the book release date to really go into your story. But and I'm reading the book, and oh my God, I mean, there's so much that I didn't even know about you, and I can't wait to go in depth with you into your story, because what happened to you is a travesty. But the reason we're talking today is you said to me after we spoke last time, you know, I know how the Democrats can win, because you have run in a number of elections in your lifetime, haven't you?
Yeah, I have. I hope you can hear me clearly.
I hear you loud.
Terrible, terrible thunderstorm here.
I hear you loud and clear. No worries.
Okay, good, because it's a little fuzzy on my end, but yes, I think I was on the ballot 17 times in Alabama. And I want your listeners to keep this in mind. I was elected to the National Board of Americans for Democratic Action in 1971 as a law student, along with Barney Frank and Kenneth Galbraith and a number of other noted left-wingers. I was active in the anti-war movement. I worked in Mississippi for the first African-American who ran for governor, Medgar Evers's brother, Charles Evers. Worked for Allard Lowenstein, the congressman from New York, worked in the Dump Johnson movement, worked for Robert Kennedy. Got a campaign contribution from my friend Jane Fonda when I was running for attorney general. But anyway, the long and short of it is, I should never really have been elected to anything in Alabama, considering Alabama's, you know, probably one of the most far right states. But my point is that if you connect with voters, they will overlook some things.
Right.
And in my case, they overlooked a lot of things because I was speaking to their interests. And my admonition and word to both Joe Biden and any Democrat who's running for office in 2020 is forget about Donald Trump.
Yep.
Everybody knows that what he's doing. Everybody knows he is stacking the government. And just recently, the national security chief is, you know, going to be one of his clones. But you know, he's firing all of the inspector generals. He's taking total control. Everybody knows what he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is speak to the interests of working families. Working families do not go to bed at night worrying about Donald Trump. They're worried about Nicole. They're worried about their children and their parents. They're worrying about paying their bills. They want their kids to have a better life than they've had. They know that starts with education. That's why we need our president, our nominee, to start speaking about universal early learning opportunities, free college education, retiring the student debt. He needs to, you know, to talk about what is important to the children of working families. He also needs to talk about their parents and grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
The working families want their parents to have a decent place to live, food on the table, and not worry about the cost of prescription drugs. You know, we live in the richest country in the world.
Mm-hmm.
No one should go to bed hungry, homeless, or without health care. Not the poor, not the mentally disabled or physically disabled or challenged, rather. And not those people behind bars. So, as Democrats, we also want, you know, we want our kids to have the opportunity to have more and better jobs, higher minimum wage. We want new uses for renewable energy to begin to combat the climate crisis that we're facing, and a president. A person running for president or a person running for the state house needs to talk about these issues.
Right.
I think, you know, you've talked on your program and other friends of mine, like Tom Hartman up north of you, has spoken about, you know, we need a president whom we can respect, who is civil, who is couth, who respects the rights of women and understands history and understands the importance of a free press to our democracy.
Right.
And even Republican women in suburbs throughout this country don't want their kid to listen to a president who uses foul language, who abuses women, who doesn't respect women. And so we have that common ground. So let's begin to speak to that. And I think most people, most working families also want a president and want people in public office who are for equal rights, who want social justice, racial justice, environmental justice, and in many cases want criminal justice reform.
Right.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Okay. No, I was going to ask you. I mean, I'm hearing all the things you're saying, and I agree 100%. This year, we face, you know, unique challenges because it's hard to get out there and campaign. Nobody can right now. And so Joe Biden is relegated to his basement. And he's not very good at these televised or, you know, Zoomed interviews. And in fact, I don't know if you heard what happened this morning with a New York radio personality, Charlemagne the God. Did you hear about this?
No, I have not.
Well, Joe Biden was the guest. Charlemagne the God is the host of this radio show, The Breakfast Club. That is, it's one of the top rated shows in New York. It's, you know, and he made that the destination for every primary presidential candidate, all the Democrats, to come on and be vetted by Charlemagne the God. I thought some of his questions of some of the people were horrible as the primary season went on. But putting that aside, this morning he's talking to Joe Biden and they do like a 18-minute interview. And at the very end, I want to play for you what Joe Biden said. Hopefully you'll be able to hear it through the phone line, because I found it astounding. And I just don't understand where Biden's coming from. So tell me if you can hear this. No, you're not going to be able to hear it because you're on the same thing. Basically, what he said is, if you have to decide, if you can't figure out between me and Donald Trump who you're voting for, then you're not really black. He said this to a black.
What?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Listen, there's no there's no point in doing things like that. Again, you know, you don't win friends and you don't build bridges to independents and suburban Republican women, which is what, honestly, I think he is going to need to win this race.
Yep.
And you can't do that if you get. Remember the story about the tar baby?
Yes.
I mean, you know, and if people always have the tendency to hit the tar baby, you know, to get stuck in this morass of politics when that's not what working people are thinking about.
Yep.
They're hurting. They want relief. They want somebody who's going to speak to their interests and somebody they can depend on to fight for them in Congress, in Washington, and you know, Biden has the capability of doing that if he would just remind people of where he came from and what he has been able to accomplish while he was in the Senate and also as vice president and working. You know, it may not be a bad idea for him to start trying to have meetings with some of the, you know, Republicans that he might be able to sway on some of these issues that impact the lives of working families now.
Right.
But, you know, It is frustrating to me as well to watch because I had hoped that he would use this time, this last 2 months, to really relate to working families through both virtual, you know, town halls and rallies, but also maybe even, you know, travel he could have hit the 50 states in the last 2 months without any problems. He's could have still made his phone calls to.
But where would he go? I mean, right now it's not like people are going out to events. I mean, if he could have gone to any state in the last month, and nobody would have come out to see him.
I was thinking he could do that, and just if nothing else, you know, have a news conference in the hangar, you know, with the media separated.
But right.
Anything to get him on the air talking about the problems that face working families in America. And it's real simple. And you just, you know, you've got to do it.
Yep.
And it takes a lot of hard work, a lot of handshaking and endless speech making. But, you know, if you talk about the wrong subject,
he's so good at opening his mouth and inserting his foot. And it was the very end of the interview. There were uncomfortable moments, as there usually are with Joe Biden. I'm sorry, he's not the most eloquent speaker, but then again, neither is his opponent. He had made it through it, and then at the very end, he says something so reprehensibly stupid that I just don't understand what he's thinking. It drives me nuts, because right now everything is at stake here, Don. We're, you know this. I mean, and this is who we're pinning our hopes on. So I'm pinning my hopes on his vice presidential pick. I had somebody email me the other day who said, so I figured it out. There's no way in hell that I can vote for Joe Biden, but I will vote for whoever the vice presidential pick is, right? And so that can make you feel good about, you know, filling in that bubble on the ballot. But that depends who it is. So we heard yesterday Amy Klobuchar floated that she's being vetted. You know, that came from her camp. We hear Kamala Harris is. Stacey Abrams is openly lobbying for the job. This is weird, because in past years, it's always been, you know, everyone denying that they're in the running or that they want it. They're all lobbying for it. Who do you think he should pick for the vice president? And do you think, as Charlemagne the God said, something that bothered me, that it has to be a black woman?
Yeah, I don't think it has to be an African American woman, and Joe has committed himself to a woman.
Yeah.
So that's a good thing, I think. It'd be nice to have a strong woman, but what the American people are going to be looking for in his choice is someone who can step in to be the leader of the most powerful country in the world.
Or what used to be and could be again.
But a wrong pick of somebody like a Dan Quayle or someone who is obviously not qualified to step into the shoes of being commander in chief then it will work to his disadvantage. So yes, he needs some help in vetting, the right candidate. I don't know who it should be. I've got my own thoughts. If I were in that situation, I think I know what I would do. But, he's got to choose carefully and wisely.
I think
it's also got to be somebody that can speak to the issues that I just spoke of. And, you know, of course, Elizabeth Warren was a great spokeswoman for, at least from my point of view. So anyway, I would, he's got to make the right choice. It's got to be somebody who's qualified to be president. But it's also got to be somebody that's going to be tough enough to take on, you know, a tax reform and creating a fair tax system.
To deal with the aftermath of the biggest, not only financial crisis of our lifetimes, but the biggest health crisis of our lifetimes. We need somebody who's really good. And, you know, I'm seeing in the chat room, somebody, Tripp, who I really respect, said it has to be Val Demings or Kamala Harris. Well, because Tripp thinks it needs to be an African-American woman. I don't. Kamala Harris, I'm sorry, I don't think should be president for a number of reasons, not having to do with her experience. Val Demings is not experienced enough. She's not ready to be president. And with Joe Biden's advanced age, I'm sorry, that has got to be a consideration.
Yeah.
Because I have a feeling whoever the running mate is going to wind up being president. Just me. It's just a feeling I have. But those are things we need to think of. And Val Demings may be a perfectly nice woman, a decent congresswoman, if you like her, former cop. But it doesn't mean she's ready to be president. Same thing with Stacey Abrams. Very smart. But the highest office she's ever held is, I think, state legislator. I think she was head of the Georgia Assembly. But again, that doesn't make you ready to be president. Look what happened the last time we elected somebody who was not ready to be president. We're in the mess we're in now. So, you know, I like Elizabeth Warren, and I hate the fact that, you know, people that I like and respect are saying, oh, no, it's got to be a woman of color. Well, really?
No, you know, let me say this. John Lewis endorsed my book.
Mm-hmm. I saw that. Very nice.
I had this bishop. Actually, I think he's out there now in California. It's T. Larry Kirkland of AME Zion Church. And I was in with him at a meeting of all of his preachers from around the Southeast, and he was looking at me in the audience, and he pointed me out, and he said, "You see this man? You see how he moves to the songs, and he has the beat and the rhythm." He said, "I think he's got some black blood in him," and he said, "I think Don Siegelman's going to be the closest thing we ever get to a black governor in the state of Alabama." Uh-huh. You don't. My point is, you don't have to be black to understand the problems and work for the people. You know, one of the reasons why I wrote this book is to protect the people who are most vulnerable. I was in prison with African-American young men who had no business being there. They were ripped away from their children and their family for piddly amounts of marijuana or cocaine. It makes no sense, and we've got to protect those folks. And you can speak to the issues that impact the lives of black and white Americans and win them over. But, you know, you don't have to have the color of your skin is not something that matters when you really reach down and speak to people and touch their hearts. So,
no, it's about your character. It's about what you believe in. And Don Siegelman, I got to tell you, again, the book, Stealing Our Democracy, will be out June 16th or 17th is the date. And 16th. And you'll be back on with me actually on the 15th, on the eve of its publication, where we're really going to go in depth. But I got to tell you, one of the first stories in the book that grabbed me was as a young man, you grew up in Alabama. I love that your name is Siegelman and people thought you were Jewish because it is kind of a Jewish name and you're not. But that's something you had to deal with in Alabama.
My grandfather was.
But, right.
You know,
but you're Catholic. But then you tell the story of when you were a schoolboy and you came home one day and you used what we now refer to as the N-word. And your father gave you a lesson. Can you tell that story? Because this is what it's about. Not the color of your skin, but, you know, sorry to steal a line from Dr. King, but your character.
Yeah, well, so I had used the word around my mother, and my mother told my dad, by the time I got home from school, my dad was there, and which was highly unusual because he was a workaholic, and I picked up his traits. But so I said, "Dad, you're home early." And he said, "Yes, son." He said, "I heard you use a bad word today." I didn't kind of know. I guess I knew what he was talking about. But
and
anyway.
What year was this? This was like 1950-something?
Oh, early 50s, 56, right after Brown versus Board of Education, right when we started, you know, having to move around to accommodate, you know, well, they were still trying to segregate schools, but anyway. So I used the N-word. Dad said, I want you to go get the dictionary. So I went into our little bedroom, and we didn't have much of a selection of books, but, you know, one Zane Grey a novel and a group of encyclopedias my mother had bought from S&H Greenstash.
She used to get them at the grocery store. I do remember those.
Anyway, so I brought the dictionary in, put it on the kitchen table. He said, now I want you to find that word. And I fumbled around and looked, and I said, Dad, I can't find it. He said, well, let me give you a hint. It's not in there. Try this word, Negro. And so he didn't say it in those terms. He politely said it. And I looked it up, and he said, now read me the definition. And I did. And he said, that's the only word we're going to use. And I won't ever hear you use that other word again. And then he asked me if I wanted to work with one of his piano delivery men. He actually was the only guy, I believe. And that Saturday, and he wanted me. I said, sure. And so I was, the gentleman came by, African-American, strong young man, picked me up at the door in the truck with a piano in the back, and we went out to, I went out to watch him deliver this piano single-handedly up, it was an upright piano, up some steps. And anyway, it was a lesson my dad was trying to teach me. And I, you know, it was something that, you know, stayed with me for the rest of my life.
What a story, and that taught you a lesson. And you've, you know, as a progressive white Democratic governor in Alabama, and this was back a while, you cared about the civil rights, you cared about the rights of all people, you worked for, I mean, some of the stories you tell in the book are incredible, and we'll save them for next time when you come on, but this is, I think, so much more important than, you know, the color of who's ever skin. It's who the person is. But anyway, just,
I had a great time throughout my career as Secretary of State, expanding voting rights and tearing down the barriers that prevented African Americans from voting. And as Attorney General, I settled one lawsuit that forced all the cities and counties to redistrict on the basis of one person, one vote, which led to the election of literally thousands of African Americans in Alabama, more elected black officials than any other state in the country. And, you know, I was able to make those kinds of changes and fight for equal opportunities for education. And one of the things that I think that attracted John Lewis was the fact that I believe that every child in this country, regardless of where they're born or to whom, regardless of the color of their skin, the economic status, whether they're immigrants or citizens, every child should have the hope and dream of being able to reach their God-given potential through education. And that's why it comes back to providing universal pre-K for every child. With the promise of, if you stay in school and stay out of trouble and make your grades, you can go on and get a higher education degree. You don't have to be a Rhodes Scholar, but if you want to gain jobs, excuse me, job skills, the country will, you know, we can pay for that. And of course, it's going to take tax reform. And Biden, as Elizabeth Warren, need to talk about closing the gap. When you have 1% with 50% of the wealth, three families with 50% of the wealth, or 1% with 92%, and large corporations and billionaires not paying any taxes, when the working people are actually subsidizing the rich, you know, we've been taught, and this is the, you know, the image that some Republicans want to paint, is that working families are taking care of the poor, that working families are taking care of the people on welfare or people who are jobless. Well, It is the working families who are taking care of the rich.
Yep.
And we've got to close those loopholes. I took that on as governor to make enough money to fulfill a commitment to education in Alabama. By closing, when Arthur Anderson went in the tank, I hired their super auditors to go after the corporations that they were cooking the books on, so they wouldn't have to pay taxes. That were doing business in Alabama, we closed those corporate loopholes and brought in enough money to fund education. But, you know, what I want to hear out of our candidates, from president on down to, you know, the state legislature, is to get away from talking about how much we don't like Donald Trump and talk about what we're going to do for
how
working families.
And
I think if we do that, we can win a bunch of elections in 2020.
Well, I hope the Democratic Party will listen to you. Don Siegelman, again, the book Stealing Our Democracy is out on June 16th. We will talk about it in depth on the 15th, the day before. Don Siegelman, pre-order the book. I'll put a link up on the blog at NicoleSandler.com where you can do that. Don Siegelman, it's always great to talk with you. Thank you. And reach out to some of the Democratic Party elders and make them listen to you.
All right. Thank you. I will make sure we don't have a thunderstorm next time we talk.
No worries.
I love you and appreciate you. Thank you so much.
Thank
Nicole.
You, Don. You have a great weekend, and I'll talk to you next
too.
Month. Okay. Bye bye. The wonderful Don Siegelman. He really is one of the really good guys. All right, and the book is just great.